So I'll talk about a very nice result of Oliver Friedman, Thomas Hansen, and Uri Zwick on proving lower bounds for the randomized pivoting rule for the simplex algorithm. And I must say these slides are by Thomas Hansen. I've just made small modifications to them. So I'll just begin by, defining what the simplex algorithm is. Many of us may have used it, but still want to remind what it is. And to state the problem. And the nice aspect of, this paper is that it draws connections to so-called Markov decision processes. And we'll see what these are and how we use the MDPs to derive these lower bounds. Okay. So just a quick reminder, a linear program is an optimization problem which has a linear objective function and a set of linear constraints. Okay. And I can represent these set of linear constraints by a matrix A, where D is the dimension of the variables and A is an n by d matrix. And it's easy to check that the set of feasible solutions to this this inequality forms a polytope, and there's always a vertex of this polytope which is the optimal solution. So the vertices are also called basic solutions, basic feasible solutions. And it is well known that for any linear objective function, the optimum value can always be found at one of the vertices. Okay. So when you want to optimize it, just means that I just need to find the best possible vertex. Okay. So now, this before we talk about the simplex algorithm, we'll first put the linear program in the standard form. And the standard form looks like this. You have a linear objective function, and then you have a set of equality constraints, Ax equals b, and the only inequality constraints are these non-negativity constraints. Okay. And it's easy to check that you can easily put any sort of this kind of linear program in the standard form. So all you have to do is introduce these slack variables, so set of new variables, let's call them y, and say ax plus y is equal to b, and y is at least 0. Okay. And if you have these variables x, which are not required to be non-negative, then you can replace them by two variables, x plus and x minus, x plus x as a difference of these two, and make both of them positive. So I can easily put any sort of linear program in this form. Okay. And this is the form of the LP that we'll work with in the rest of the talk. Okay. Now, what is a vertex solution here? A vertex, remember, corresponds to a set of, so the number of variables here is m, which is d plus n, which is bigger than the number of constraints. So think of A as a fact matrix. So if there are m variables, you need m constraints, the m equality constraints to form a vertex. N of these are coming from Ax equals b, so you need m minus n more from the inequality constraints. Right? So, so what will happen is that a vertex will correspond to exactly sort of d non-negative variables. The rest of them will always be 0. That makes sense. All right. So let me just write it. So you have Ax equals b. So there are n of these, and then you have x equals 0. And there are m variables. So you want n of these equalities are coming from here. So you want m minus n of these to be satisfied with equality. Right? So only n of these will be non-zero. Okay. So a basis is defined as a subset of columns, essentially, which are linearly independent. Okay. Okay. So all, remember, you have m minus n equality constraints here, so those variables will be set to 0. And the only n variables which form part of the basis could be non-zero. They could still be 0, but in general will not be 0. And so that's a vertex. And how does the simplex algorithm behave? It starts with a vertex and goes to a nearby vertex. Okay, so that is called pivoting. Okay. So what pivoting does is that you start with a basic solution, a vertex solution, and among the neighborhood, you figure out which vertex is better than the current vertex, okay, and you move to that vertex. Now, in terms of the actual algebra, it basically says that you're given a set of basic, you're given basic feasible solutions. So what you do is you take one basic variable out and bring one new basic variable in. Okay. So you take out one equality constraint, make it inequality, and bring a new inequality constraint and make it 0. That's like moving along an edge. So let's see the picture. So you start with, let's say, this basic solution here. And there are three edges here. And let's say you move along this because your, let's say, objective function points along this direction. So you move along this, you improve the value of the objective function. Then when you're here, you again move along this because, I mean, both of these directions will improve the objective function. So you pick one of these directions and let's say you move along this direction. Now when you're here, you could either move back or you can move along this direction. But because you want to locally always improve your solution, you'll always move along the direction in which your objective function improves. Okay, so that is the simplex algorithm. Okay, so now it's because of the dual, yeah, so I've not proved that if you are at a vertex so that you cannot go to a better vertex, then you are at an optimum. So that it follows essentially because everything is linear. So as long as you can move along a better direction, you're improving the value of the solution. If you cannot improve the value of the solution, then you're at an optimum. So let's see a quick example. So this is, let's say you are given an LP of this form, okay? First of all, you put it in the standard form by introducing the slack variables. So I add some more variables, x4, x5, x6, so that it comes to the standard form. And now I'll start with a basic solution. So remember, a basic feasible solution will, what it will do is because there are six variables, it will it needs six equality constraints. So it will set three of these to 0, and the other three will form part of the basic solution. Okay? So let's say you pick a basis here, which is a basic solution, which is 4, 5, 6. Okay? So what that means is that I'm going to set x1, x2, and x3 to 0. Okay? And if I write my set of equality constraints in this form, it's easy to read off what x4, x5, x6 are. Right? So the value of x4 is 1, this one is 2, and this one is 1. Okay? So my current solution is x1 is 0, x2 is 0, x3 is 0, and x4, x5, x6 are 1, 2, 1. So this is the current point, okay? And now, if you look at the objective function, you can immediately see how I can improve my solution. So the coefficient of, remember this is a maximization problem, so the coefficient of x1 is 2. So if I slightly increase x1, my objective value will only improve. Okay, so that's what I try to do. I increase x1. Now you can increase x1 as long as you don't violate the inequality constraints. So when you increase x1, what is going to happen is that at some point of time, x4 will become 0, okay, and you'll stop at that point. And you will get a new basis. Okay. So you start with this solution, and then you move. You have three options, and you can either move from this vertex to this vertex, this vertex to this vertex, or this to this. But because you want to improve your solution, you will always move along the direction. Okay. So you go to a new vertex, 1, 5, 6. And again, when you look at the objective function, at this point, you see that I can either increase x2 or I can increase x3. In both these cases, I will be able to improve my solution. Okay, so I pick one of these. Which one to pick is, again, what is called the pivoting rule. And that's where all the sort of interesting thing happens. So let's say I pick one of these. Okay, so suppose I increase x2, then x1 will always be OK, actually. Right? The x5 at some point of time will become 0. Okay, I'll have to stop at that point, and so on. So you keep moving in this manner till you reach a point where, when you look at the objective function, this is how it will look like, right? All the coefficients here will be negative. Okay? If you reach a point like this, you know that you are at an optimal solution. Why? Because right now your current solution puts x4, x5, x6 as 0, right? Now, if you don't put them 0, you will only decrease the value of the solution. So you are at an optimal solution. So that's how this method works. And now there is a theorem which says that assuming that the polytope is feasible and it's not unbounded, one of these two things will always happen. Assuming we don't, so if everything is negative, then you are done. If there is some coefficient which is not negative, then you can always improve the solution. Okay. And I'm not talking about the degenerate cases which can happen if some of the coefficients are zero, even if everything is zero, let's say, or everything, yeah, so let's not worry about it. So if all coefficients are negative, then the solution is. So what are the choices here? The choices that we have to make are, as we said, when you have several non-basic variables which with positive coefficient in the objective function, you can, let's say here, for example, you can either increase x2 or you can increase x3, right? So which of these two should I pick? Okay, and they're very natural rules which allow, say, tell you what to do. Okay, and in the case of a tie, suppose, let's say I'm increasing some variable here. Let's say here I'm increasing x3. And let's say two of these simultaneously become zero. So which one do you take out of the basis? And this is what is called the pivoting rule. It tells you along which edge you should move. Okay. Now the first such rule, natural rule, was by Danzig. It said that given that you want to locally improve your solution as much as possible, why not pick the variable which has the highest negative, highest positive coefficient. So that now there were some problems with this rule. The main issue with this rule was that it led to what is called cycling. That is, in case of a tie, it can lead to situations where you can keep on cycling. So I'll not go into that. In fact, none of the LPs that we will write will lead to any degeneracy. So the second rule was called Blant's rule. It says that among all the variables that are eligible to be increased at this time, you pick the one with the smallest index. Okay. And similarly for leaving the basis. Okay. And this rule was nice because it guaranteed that it will never lead to cycling. So it will always converge. Okay. So now, then people said that, okay, so let's say we have proved convergence, but how much time can these things take? And in 1972, Klee and Minty showed that the first rule here, so let's assume that you never even get to the case where cycling happens. Even then, it can lead to exponential number of steps, okay? So, and the examples were like this, okay? So let's look at the following optimization problem. You want to maximize Xn, and where you have a set of linear constraints here. And this, the set of polytopes defined by these set of linear constraints really looks like a cube, okay? But almost like a deformed cube. So if epsilon is zero, it's exactly a cube. For a very tiny value of epsilon, it really resembles a cube. And so I can still index the vertices as 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, and so on, even though these are not exactly those coordinates, but you can think of it as a cube. And if you're starting from 0, 0, 0, the optimal solution is, of course, at the top here, because you want to maximize the smallest index, xn. So I can move from here to here in one step, okay? But what one can easily show is that if you're following this rule, if you start from here, I can keep on moving along all along a Hamiltonian path in this graph. Okay, so think of the edges as forming a graph. Then I'll move along essentially all the vertices in this graph. Okay, and each of them will be an improving step. Okay, and in fact, the largest coefficient rule will in fact pick this long path. Okay. So subsequent to this, people proposed many other pivoting rules. So then they said that instead of looking at the largest coefficient, let's look at the one which leads to the largest increase in the objective function. Okay, or why not look at the one where the edge has the highest slope? Then of course the Blant's rule. Then there was this shadow vertex rule, which I will not go into. But this was the pivoting rule for which it was shown that the smoothed complexity is polynomial time. So the whole set of rules, but for all of these, people could come up with examples for which the simplex will take exponential number of steps. Okay. Now a little bit about what does it say about the diameter of the polytope. So remember, the diameter of a polytope is the maximum distance between any two vertices in the polytope. And no matter what algorithm I use, as long as I just walk along the vertices of the simplex, a lower bound that I can come up with is the diameter of the polytope. Right? So diameter is large, then I'll obviously take a lot of steps. Now there's a very famous conjecture, it's called Hirsch conjecture, which said that diameter of any n facet polytope in d dimensions is at most n minus d. So it will say that the diameter is always small, so perhaps one could imagine that there would be an algorithm which will take small number of steps. Now very recently a counter example was given to this bound by Santos. This is 1 plus a very small number times n minus d. So this Hirsch conjecture is not true, but it is possible that the diameter would be, let's say, n plus d, or small constant times n plus d, or some polynomial in n plus d. Okay, so those things could still exist. Now one natural pivoting rule would be, how about among all the possible edges which are improving my solution, why not take a random. So this was called the randomized pivoting rule, and it was a big open problem for last 30 years to see, to analyze this rule. Yeah, so let's say that you can start from, let's say this is the diameter, right? Then I can always find an objective function for which this is the optimal solution. And if you start from here, then it would be. So in this paper, the authors show that even the randomized pivoting rule can lead to exponential number of steps. And however, this does not say anything about the diameter of the polytope, because in fact, the polytopes that we will see here will have very small diameter, okay. Something like n, linear in the size of variables. So this is the pivoting rule, that you pick a random non-basic variable with the positive, which has a positive coefficient. Similar to the random edge rule, there was another rule called a random facet rule. So the random facet rule says the following, that when you are at a vertex, there are several facets on which this vertex lies. You pick a random facet, okay, and you recursively solve the problem on this facet. Okay, so let's say you come to a vertex in this facet, and now if it helps, you would like to leave this facet. Okay, that edge which takes you out of this facet, if it helps, you would like, you can try to leave that. So, and for this random facet rule, Kalai and others had shown that it takes sub-exponential number of steps, okay, so something which is less than 2 to the n. And it was an open problem to give a lower bound for this rule. Okay. So the main results of this paper are, it shows that the random edge rule requires 2 to the n to the 1/4 pivoting steps in expectation, and similarly random facet rule requires a sub-exponential number of steps. Okay. And so it says that even the randomized pivoting rules do not help in simplex. And the nice thing about this paper is that all the previous lower bounds for pivoting rules were based on some on constructions which relied on some deformation of cubes and some simple polytopes like these, because it's hard to sort of think about polytopes which are very complex. However, by going via this, by Markov decision processes, what we will see is that the kind of polytopes we construct are very complex, but still we can talk about them. And there's a well-known algorithm called policy iteration algorithm, which we'll talk about for solving MDPs. Turns out that it's exactly the simplex algorithm running on a related LP that we'll see. Okay, so by talking about this policy iteration algorithm, we'll be saying something about the simplex algorithm. Should say that the same technique has been used at several other places. For example, there is a rule called Zadeh's least entered pivoting rule. So unlike the other pivoting rule, this rule maintains a memory. So it remembers that which variable has been added to your basis how many times. So when you come to a new vertex, you add that non-basic variable which has been used the least number of times. So it, it has a memory. But even those these kind of rules have been shown to take. So it's a very powerful technique. Okay. So now what I'll do is we'll talk about Markov decision processes and see where the connection to linear programming comes. So what's a Markov chain? A Markov chain, as we all know, is an, you can think of it as an n by n matrix, which suppose it has n states, and the rows of the matrix adds up to 1. So Pij tells you that if you are in state I, what's the probability of going to state j? So let's say you start from state 1, then you from state 1, you will go to state 2. Now at state 2, you have half a probability of going to either 1 or 2, 3, and so on. So let's say you start with state 1, then next step you go to state 1. Now at the next step I can go back or forth and so on. And I can maintain this here, I can maintain, so initially I'm with probability 1, let's say I'm state at state 1 and then I can represent this as a vector. And as I take steps, I can maintain a vector which represents the probability distribution at that step, right? So, at step 3, I am at state 1 with probability 1/4, state 2 at with probability half, and state 4 with probability 1/4. Okay. And the way I can do this is, let's say B is your initial probability distribution. In this case, B is, let's say, 1/0/0. And as you take more steps, the next probability distribution will just be given by multiplying the current vector by P. So, I mean, it's not important, but. Okay, so you can kind of follow, as you take more steps, it just corresponds to multiplying by this matrix P. Now, let's talk about Markov chains which have rewards in them. Now, here, it's exactly like a Markov chain, except that you have a reward on each state. Right? So whenever you come to a state, when you take the next step, you get that much reward. Okay? So you have a vector C, which tells you what is the reward for leaving each state I. And now we would like to know that if you start with a particular distribution, what's the total reward I will accumulate as I keep on moving in this Markov chain. Now, so remember this B transpose P to the K tells you the probability distribution at step K. So this vector here, this inner product tells you what's your expected reward at step K. And when you add up over all values of K, it tells me my total accumulated reward over time. And this could be unbounded. So normally what people can do, people do is you either have a state which is an absorbing state. So you will always reach that state with probability 1. And then once you get there, then you just stay there. So that will basically truncate this series after a finite amount of time. Or people also add discount factors to make this converge. In our case, all the Markov chains that we will build will always have a terminal state, where you will always reach with probability 1. And the last thing is that the value of a state I is the total reward that I expected when I start at this state. Okay. So now I can define what a Markov decision process is. So it looks like this. You have a set of states. So here, for example, there are 3 states. And associated with each state, I have a set of actions. So with state I have a set of actions AI. So for example, here is with state 1, I have 2 actions A1, A2. With state 2, I have 2 actions A3 and A4, and so on. Okay. So the idea is that when you come to a state, you will take one of the actions. Let's say I take action A1. Okay, and then this state tells me how much reward I will get. So suppose I take action A1, so I get 7 units of reward. Okay, it's like a Markov chain with reward. And once I get to this state, it's exactly like a Markov chain. It gives me a probability distribution on which, what is the next state I will go to. Okay, so let's say I'm in state 1, I take action A1. Now when I'm here, I'll go to state 2 with probability half or state 3 with probability half. Okay, and so on. Right, so more formally, you have a state, and with each state, you have a set of actions. Now each action has an associated reward, which could be a negative number. And and also a probability distribution such that this distribution tells me that which is the next state that I will go to. So, and the point is that you would like to decide on a strategy for each state. So, for example, if I am at a state, what I would like to know is that which of the two actions or which of the three actions I should take. Okay. So, for example, think of this policy. It tells me that if I am at state 1, I will take action A1. Okay. If I am at state 2, I will take action A4, and so on. Okay. Now, once you fix this strategy, it becomes like a Markov chain with rewards, right? Because now there is no indecision at any state. Okay. You know exactly which action to take. So it exactly becomes a Markov chain. Okay. So that's what a policy is. It tells you which action to take at each state. Okay. And once you fix the policy, it becomes a Markov chain with rewards. So you can again define what's the value of a state with respect to a policy. And a policy is optimal if it maximizes the values of all of the states. So among all any other policy pi and state I, the value that I will derive from pi star will be higher than any other policy. Okay. So such a policy I'll call as an optimal policy. Now, it's a non-trivial fact that there always will be an optimal policy. Okay. So there is a single policy which will simultaneously maximize the expected value for all these states. Okay. And the goal is that you want to find this policy. So that's what an MVP. Yeah, okay. So that you can show that a randomized policy will not help you, right? So if there is an optimal policy which is randomized, there's also one which is just deterministic. So you might as well just focus on these kind of things. Now, before we go on, a little bit of notation. Instead of representing the Markov decision process in that manner, I'll have a more sort of compact way of representing them. This is called a graphical representation. The way it works is the following. Like an MDP, this is an MDP, so you have a set of states which I will denote by these circles. Okay. So there are 4 states here. And then you have some diamond-shaped vertices which will tell me what the rewards are. Okay. And third kind of vertices I'll have are what are called these randomization vertices. So all they do is that when you come to a randomization vertex, it will tell you what is the next vertex you'll move to, and will tell me a probability distribution over that. Okay, so if you come to this state, it will tell me that with 1/3 probability you go here, with 2/3 you go here. Okay. So that's what a randomization vertex is. Okay, so the only difference with this earlier definition is that this randomization vertex can be sort of part of a graph. It could be shared by several states. Okay, and it's easy to check that. If you have, how do you move here? So let's say you start from this state. Now you can either go to state T directly, or you can come to this randomization vertex. If you come to this randomization vertex, what it will do is that with 1/3 probability, it will take you here. With 2/3 probability, it will take you here. And in this way, you can move in this graph. Okay. So it's a graph where you can, if you are at a state, you will take an action of the set of outgoing edges. If you are at a randomization vertex, you will come to a new vertex depending on the distribution. And if you are at a reward vertex, it has exactly one outgoing edge, and you will collect that reward and go to the next vertex. And just a compact way of representing an MDP. You can write an MDP corresponding to this, but that will be just a bigger thing. Okay. And again, the policy is a set of outgoing edges, one outgoing edge for every vertex. So once you fix a policy, you can figure out what is the value of each state. For example, here in this state, you will collect 0 reward. If you are in this state, with 2/3 probability, you will not collect any reward. With 1/3 probability, you will collect 6 units of reward. So the value here is 2, and so on. Okay. So you can easily compute the value of each of the states. Okay. So now the goal is to find a policy which maximizes the sum of the values. Because we know that there is a single policy which is optimal for each of the states. So it's also optimal for the sum of the values. Okay. So that's what you want to find. Okay. And if you think about it, let's think about it in the following way. Suppose your initial distribution is uniform distribution. So I'm just writing it as all ones. I'm taking out the scaling factor. And this is, at the next step, you come to a new distribution, at the next step you come to a new distribution, and so on. What's the value of a state? The value of the state is the sum of all the column entries for that state, right, scaled by the C. So once you fix a policy, the value of a state is you just add up all the column entries. So in other words, let XA be the number of times a particular action A is used, okay? So that will be just, so for example, if action A is going out of state 3, then XA will be just the sum of all the entries for state 3, okay? So the total value of all the states is, I can write it as sum over all states I, and remember you will choose exactly one action here for in a policy. So CA, the how much benefit you get out of that action, times the number of times you will use this action. So let's write a linear program. So for example, this is your objective function. You want to maximize the total value that you accumulate, and XA represents how many times you will use this action A. So if this is a state and these are the outgoing edges and these are the incoming edges, then the claim is that the number of times you take these outgoing edges is equal to 1 plus the number of times you will enter this state. Why? Where is this 1 coming from? This 1 is coming from this initial 1 here, right? Okay. Because you're initially giving a charge of 1 to every state. And when you move around, whenever you enter a state, you will leave the state as well, right? Okay. So it's like a flow conservation constraint. So whatever is the inflow at a vertex is 1 plus the outflow. Sorry, whatever is the outflow is 1 plus the inflow. Right? So outflow is all actions. You add up the XA values, and the inflow is essentially this quantity. Right? So for every other state, what's the chance of coming to this state? And you sum it up, that gives you the inflow. Okay. So let's write the LP for this MDP that will make it clear. Okay. So let's not worry about the actual policy right now. So you have, how many variables will I have? I have one variable for every action. So for this state, I have two variables. For this state, there are two possible actions. So I have two variables, and again, I have two variables here. So there are six variables. What's the objective function? So if I take action, this action corresponding to x1, if I take it x1 times, each time I take this action, I have 1/3 probability of getting 6 units of reward, and with 2/3 probability I go to a new state. Okay, so this action gives me a benefit of 2. So that's why I have a 2 here. Okay. Similarly, if you look at x2, it directly takes me to the sink, so it gives me 0 reward. If you think of x3, if I am at this state, then x3 will take me to this state, which will give me -4 reward. From here, I'll go here, and I know that from here, I'll get a reward of 2 in expectation. So that's why you have a -2 here, okay? For x5, here, again, the same thing, exactly the same thing. When I take the action corresponding to x5, I'll get -4 units of reward, and then I get +2 more. So that's why -2. And if I take x6, I'll always get -1 unit of reward, and then I'll get to a new state. That's why I have -1. Okay, so I can write the LP in this form. Okay, let's look at the constraints. So if you look at, let's say, this vertex, what are the possible actions? Well, there is x1 and there is x2. Right? So x1 plus x2 is 1 plus the total incoming flow. What's the incoming flow? Well, if I take action x1, then there is a 2/3 chance of coming back. Right? So that's 2/3 x1. Right? So each time you take x1, there is a 2/3 probability of coming back. Similarly for x3, whenever you take x3, there is a 2/3 chance of coming here. So that's why it says 2/3 x3, similarly for x5. Okay, so that's the constraint corresponding to this state. For let's say this state, the outgoing is x3 plus x4, it's 1 plus, if you take action x6, you will definitely end up here, otherwise you will not end here, so 1 plus x6. Similarly, for this state, x5 plus x6 is equal to 1. There is no incoming flow. So that's the kind of LP I can write down for this MDP. Is it clear? Okay. So this is the LP. And now the question is, what's a basic feasible solution for this LP? Now, I claim that the basic feasible solution for this LP is exactly a policy. Why? Remember, how many non-zero variables can I have? If n is the number of states, it's easy to check that you will have exactly n non-zero variables. Okay? So you have one non-zero variable corresponding to each state. Okay? One of these variables must be non-zero. Why? Because you have a 1 here. Okay? So for each constraint, one of these x's must be non-zero. All of them cannot be 0. Okay? So exactly 1 will be non-zero. And because you have n states, so there's one non-zero variable for each state. So the basis consists of exactly a policy. Okay? So that's what a policy is. Okay? And in fact, the converse is also true. A policy pi corresponds to a basic solution. So we'll not go. Okay. And what does the simplex algorithm do? Simplex algorithm says that if you write a current basic solution, move to a different basic solution, where it just changes one base variable. So essentially, the simplex algorithm corresponds to the following, that look at a state. If this is the current action, can I improve the solution by changing this action to a different action? And every other action stays as it is. So that's what a simplex step is. Okay. So for example, here, if you look, if I change this action from this one to the other one, the value of the state goes up from 0 to 2. Right? So that's an improving step. Okay. So that's what the simplex algorithm is. So the nice thing is that instead of thinking about polytopes and moving along edges, I have been able to think about in terms of this local search kind of algorithm, right? That you have a policy and you just change one action in this policy and see if it improves your solution. If it does, then you take that action. Okay. Now, for MDPs, what you can also do is you can simultaneously improve several of these actions. Okay. So let's say I change this action to this one and maybe this one to this one also. I can change two or three action simultaneously, but we'll not go into that. Okay, so this is the algorithm. Okay, so the algorithm says the following: while there is an improving switch, so you're given a policy pi, update pi by performing a switch. Okay, and by switch I basically mean that you take an action and change it to something, some other action from that state. Okay, right. So and the simplex algorithm is a special case of this algorithm where you're only taking one improving state at a time. Okay. So this is the well-known policy iteration algorithm. And simplex algorithm exactly corresponds to this, provided you just improve one action at a time. And so this is all we need to analyze now. Okay, so let's look at the example. So this is the LP corresponding to this policy. Okay, so this is the basic solution. And I've written it in this form then. And let's say that you realize that the coefficient of x1 is positive. So let's try to increase x1. And that corresponds to changing this action to this new one. Okay, that's what it is. Now again, you see that if you switch this action to this one, you will improve the solution. So you take that action and so on. Okay, keep on moving till you come to a solution which is optimal. Okay, so the theorem is that if you cannot find a locally improving action, then you are at an optimal solution. So same as the simplex algorithm. Okay. So now I'll briefly talk about how you use this for proving lower bounds for the simplex algorithm. And remember that what does the random edge rule correspond to? Random edge rule corresponds to that among all the actions which can improve your solution, just pick one random action. Okay. All right. So what I'll do is we'll first see the lower bound for a special case where we don't use randomization at all. We just use Bland's rule. And once we see that, then we'll see how to add the randomization to it. Okay. Okay. Just some notation. Remember these corresponds to vertices which tell me how much reward there is. And all the rewards are sort of exponentially increasing in nature. So if I say reward is 5, it basically means that it is minus some large number raised to the power 5. So the idea is that if you can get reward of 6, then all the previous rewards are meaningless for you. Okay. And because there's a negative sign here, the odd numbers give me negative rewards, and the even number gives me even rewards, positive reward. So you would like to get a reward which is as high as possible and even number. And once you get that reward, all the previous ones are meaningless because they are exponentially increasing in nature. Okay, all right. So the way the so where does the sort of how do we account for the how do we prove that the lower bound takes exponential amount of time? Well, the way I'll encode this is the following. Remember, there are at each state I have several actions that I can take. Okay, so in our construction, each state will have either one action or two actions available to it. Now, when a state has two actions, I'll number them as 0 or 1, corresponding to 0, 1, and a policy will now just tell me which of these should I take the 0 action or the 1 action. Okay, and what I would like to do is that the I'd like to take my algorithm through a sequence of steps which will correspond to going through all sequence of n bit numbers. So let's say that there are let's say focus on the b's, the vertices labeled b's here, and remember there are two actions here. You can take an action 0 or you can take an action 1. So we will go through the details of this in a minute. And similarly, through this state, I can take two actions. I can take a 0 action or take a 1 action. Okay. So let's say you take 0 action, then this will correspond to the 0, 0. Okay. Then you will see that because of the other things, the next state, the next set of next policy that you will have will be 0, 1. Okay. You will take action 1 here, 0 here. The next policy that you will get will be 1 plus this. Then the next one will be 1 plus this, and so on. So it will take you through all the 2 to the n policies. Okay, so we'll start with all 0 policy. So if there are n of those, if there are n vertices which are like this, so here there are just 2 of these vertices, b1 and b2. In general, I'll have n of these vertices, and they will take me through. I'll show that the simplex algorithm will take me through a sequence of 2 to the n steps, and if in the ith step I'm at a number corresponding to the setting of these n variables, then at the next step I'll be at a step which will be 1 plus the current setting of these. Did that make sense? So let's say you are at 0, 0 right now. In the next step you will be at 0, 1. In the next one you will be at 1, 0, and then at 1, 1. Okay? So take me through all the 2 to the n setting of these variables. So let's do this quickly and okay. So let's see why this happens. So suppose this is your current policy. Okay, what's the policy? The policy tells you that which of these 2 actions you will take. Okay, so let's say at this vertex you take the action labeled 0, at this vertex you take action labeled 0, and so on. Okay, so there are 2 levels to this. Okay, so in general there will be n levels where each level will look like this. So I've just drawn 2 levels. And if the state of this level is 0, that means that everybody is taking action which is labeled 0. Similarly, everybody here is taking action which is labeled 0. Okay. Now, how can I improve my solution? If you think about it, if you look at this state B1, right now it's going directly towards T. It's getting 0 amount of benefit. If it takes action 1, it will get 6 amount of benefit and then it will go to T. Right? So that's an improvement step for it. Similarly, look at this state, if it takes this action 1, it will take it to, it will give it 10 units of benefit. Okay, all other states will not get any benefit from switching. Okay, so I let's say remember the current state is 0, 0, and so you want to go to 0, 1. Okay, because 0, 0 plus 1 is 0, 1. So what I'll do is I can pick either this improving step or I can pick this improving step. So let's say I pick the lower one. So I pick this improving step. Okay. So this becomes 1. Now if you see, once you do this, this also becomes an improving step. Why? Because the vertex U1 will realize that currently it is getting 0 amount of profit, but going through the 6 it will get better. Okay. So all of these lower levels, they switch. And this becomes 1, 0, okay, 0, 1. Now what happens in the next step? Next step you see that from 0, 1 you want to go to 1, 0, right? because 0, 1 plus 1 is 1, 0. Now what happens is, again, this B2 vertex realizes that I can get 10 units of money by just switching from 0 to 1. Okay, so it does that. And similarly, these things will switch as it happened in the previous step. Now the nice thing is, however, look at this vertex B1 now. It realizes that right now it is getting 6 amount of money, but 10 is much bigger than 6. So now that B2 takes me to 10, I can take the 0 action and go and collect this amount of money. Okay, so that's what it does. Okay, so it takes the 0 step and collects this amount of money. Okay, I'm not showing you all the details of this this construction, but the idea is that you design a gadget which allows you to go through all of these states, where a state basically corresponds to a set of actions for each vertex. Okay, and you cycle through all the 2 to the n steps. Now the only thing to notice is, even if you didn't follow this, is that for this to work, the following is required, right? That you require that if there are several possible switches, you pick the one which suits you, right? So if, for example, in the previous one, if you wanted to go from 00 to 01, you would rather like to switch from this 0 to 1 rather than from this 0 to 1, right? You don't want to take this step, you want to take this one, okay? Bland's rule, this improvement corresponds to Bland's rule. So Bland's, if you just follow Bland's rule, you will see that this is what you will do. But what about the random pivot rule? Random pivot rule says that you can pick either of these two with equal probability. So if you pick this one, then you will not follow that sequence. Okay. So what happens in the random pivot rule? So for that to happen, we need to add some more gadgets. We want to say that the way this will do is, I'll just skip this. That you will replace each of these vertices by a gadget. The gadget, what it does is that it delays the switch from this state to this state. Okay, how does it delay? It adds a cycle here. Okay, so it says that for this switch to happen, several switches will need to happen. Okay, so right now think of replacing this vertex by a path here, and if you want to switch from this policy to this policy, all of these blue edges must switch pointing up. So you add a much longer cycle here, okay? And now remember that you two different switches were competing with each other. For example, you want one of these to happen before the other one. So how do you build that? What you say is that there will be two cycles, one corresponding to this vertex, one corresponding to this vertex. And if you want this one to happen before this happens, what you will do is that in the gadget, this will be a shorter cycle than this cycle. So this is what we will do. We'll design a long path here. And for the switch to happen, I want all of these three edges to point upwards. And I will design for various vertices, different vertices, these paths will have different lengths. Okay. So, and then it's easy to check that if there are two chains, one of length Li and the other is of length Li plus 1, if you want this chain to close before this chain closes, then it can be arranged with high probability, provided the chains are, you know, increasing in size. So there is some parameter which tells me at what ratio these chains should increase. Okay, so let's not go into this. Okay, so this is how the construction looks. That it's exactly as before, but now instead of single vertex, you have a chain here. And what that chain does is that it adds a random delay to the switching. Okay, and by allowing these chains to be of different length, you can make one the event that you really want to happen before the other one happens. Okay, so there's a long chain here, there's even a longer chain here, even a longer chain here, and so on. So that's what that happens. Okay, let's not go into the details here. Now, however, this is not all, because let's say that you're building this chain and you want all of these to point in the up direction. However, let's say one of these points in the up direction and the other two do not point in the up direction. So what you would like to do is that you would like to reset this chain so that you come back to the zero state. So the zero state corresponds to the case when everybody is pointing in the forward direction. So for that, they need to build another gadget. I don't have time for that, which allows you to do all this. Okay. So this is how the final construction looks like. But I guess the main point is that the connection with MDPs allowed you to look at very complex polytopes, which were not possible if you're just looking at cube or some modifications of the cube. And you can encode actions as binary strings. And you can design the set of actions so that it takes you to go through all of these sequences. Okay, so this is the final theorem that they have. Just have one slide for. So if you really look at the linear program, this is how the LP looks like. Okay, so it's a pretty complex LP, and it would have been hard to come of this directly. But because one can go through the MDPs, one really does not have to think about the LPs at all. These are all very big open problems. Can one give a strongly polynomial time algorithm for solving MDPs? Of course, we don't know a strongly polynomial time for solving LPs, but MDPs are special kinds of LPs, so that's a big open problem. The other problem is, of course, prove or disprove the Hirsch conjecture. Okay. Thanks.